One is the words of God. The words of God, listen, is truth, whether we want to believe that or not. The other one is personal experience. I can tell you folks that when you've got personal experience with anything of God, especially healing, it's not so hard the next time to believe when trouble comes your way, or a pain comes your way, or a bad doctor's report comes your way, or in any aspect of your life begins to hit you, whether it be works of the enemy or whether it just self-inflicted. I know folks don't want to hear that, but a lot of things that goes on in our life, they're self-inflicted. They are. We don't want to admit to that, but they are. But nevertheless, give me just a second to find my hanky, because I can't work without my hanky. Anyway, sometimes when we begin to look into the words of God, we read scripture like I just read to you, and we think, man, what it must have been like to be back in the days when great healing like that was going on. Well, look, can I ask you, as children of God, and I'm sure that there's folks in here today that has a lot more education, a lot more time invested in study and all of that in the words of God. Can I ask you, if you could tell me, listen, I'm sitting there right now and be quiet. If you can show me where it stopped, if you can show me where healing was just for the days of Jesus, or healing was just for the days of the disciples, if you can show me, I see where it started, but I can't find a stopping point. There's no stopping point in the words of God. So why do we as people of God, listen, think somehow, I know we've been taught through the years and in lack of faith in many areas in our life, why the great power of God is not working in our lives anymore. Now when you notice I said our, listen, I'm not here to beat you up as children of God. I'm here to try to help each and every one of us to understand we are in difficult days, folks. We're in a day where it's black out in that world and nobody gives no hope anymore. It seems like there's a lack of faith in the land, and all of these things are going on, but nevertheless, the words of God changes not. Yeah. So one of my favorite scriptures I shared with you just now about this man with a withered hand. I'm not just focusing on this man, because we're going to back up a day or two and go forward an hour or two in the life of Jesus. And I thought about this man with this withered hand. Do you know what the word withered means? I know everybody in here knows. It means simply that his hand was drawn up. This man was not able to use his hand like you and I do now. And besides all of that, it was his right hand. I know some folks are left-handed, but most people are right-handed. And right-handed, what this hand of this man was a very important part of his body. It was why, listen, he couldn't do some of the things that you and I take for granted in our life, like pick up our grandchildren and throw them up in the air and catch them. He couldn't do that. He was deprived of that. He couldn't, listen, play baseball with his grandson because of his withered hand. He couldn't do. He could raise his hands, but in praise unto God, like you and I have the privilege to do and won't sometimes. But he had that withered hand, and this hand was a deformity in his life. And no doubt in my mind that many a time, maybe when he was in the church, how he wanted to raise both hands, but he was ashamed of that hand, maybe. Maybe he was uncomfortable with the way it looked because it was drew up. But the bottom line is, this man had a withered hand, but his life was getting ready to change one Sabbath day. See, we don't understand about this day. Listen, folks, this day, this week, listen, could be one of the greatest times in your life as a child of God, if you and I would listen and listen intently and understand that God still is a church and I see young people. And oh, how healthy we are when we're teenagers and when we're in our early 20s and 30s and even 40s sometimes. And it goes on in other people's life. But we seem to not have a care in the world. But we need healing in our lives as young people also. There may be a relationship you're getting ready to step into, and you're a child of God, and you need direction. You need healing to be able to get a right mind, to be able to make the right decision. Because listen, decisions you make today will affect your tomorrow. So therefore, we need a healing in our mind sometimes. We need to be able to let go and let God. We need to be able to do what God's Word says to do instead of what we want to do. So there's so many areas in our life that we can get a healing today from God. I tell you, young folks, I brag on young folks all the time because it blesses my heart to see young people in church today. I tell you, because the world ain't got much to offer them out there, folks. But, so they're looking at you older folks, and us older folks, I'll put it that way. Listen, as role models, so we need to do everything we can to encourage them. That's why I like to see them singing and doing whatever they can for the kingdom of God. But getting back to this man, I keep getting away from him. I want you to, if you would go there with me just for a minute. And I'm going somewhere with this, if you'll give me a minute or two. I want you to picture, put yourself in this church service. It must have been a crowded place that day. And Jesus, God, listen, was there in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. And out of all the people in that place, listen, the rulers and the scribes were there, the so-called church leaders, the ones who should have knew God, but because of love and compassion and a born-again experience, they knew the law and they knew the word, but they didn't know Jesus. And I tell you, you can have all the education you want, but if you don't have a knowledge of Jesus himself, the Son of the living God, we're missing in our lives. So Jesus looked over that crowd that day, and out of all people in the place, and surely there was other problems there in many other lives, but he saw this man with a withered hand. Most people would have, in fact, the scribes and the Pharisees, no doubt that maybe had shook that man's left hand a few times, I don't know, but the bottom line is they knew that this man, he had attended church before, he was a regular there, if you will, but nevertheless, this day, his life was going to change forever, because when Jesus looked down, and maybe he had his hands raised in the air, and one was up, and the other was withered. Nevertheless, Jesus seen his infirmity. He knew what he needed, and he knows what you need. In here today, we, a lot of times, we hide behind even our Christianity sometimes. We hide behind it, and we go home, and we struggle with relationship, and we struggle financially, and we struggle in many different areas of our life, but God has a healing for you. Amen. This day, in this place, amen, God has it for you. It's the God we serve. Now, I want you again to picture this man with his hands raised in the air, but the withered hand in his life, it touched the Lord's heart. And when Jesus saw that withered man, then he began to ask him, he said, well, listen, he never made that man do a thing. And God will not make you do nothing in here today. He will present his word to you, and he will send his spirit to confirm it in your heart, but you've got to do the rest in here. And so Jesus said, sir, and he looked right at the man, and he fastened his eyes upon him, and said, sir, he said, stand up in the midst. And immediately, I never seen no hesitation at all when I read it, because the man stood in the midst, and he stood up, and as he stood up, Jesus felt his hurt. He seen his pain. He saw it days past when he couldn't do the thing that everybody else was doing. No doubt that the enemy had worn trade for many years, and I still got 10 fingers. I got a lot of folks, friends of mine, it's lost fingers, and mine in accidents and all that, but I've been blessed with mine. And a lot of times I take for granted that I got 10 fingers, you know. We're blessed, folks. But this man, listen, he was getting ready to get a life-changing experience, and when Jesus told him to stand up in the midst, immediately he stood up. See, and listen, see what the man had to do? He had to respond to what the Word of God said. He had to respond to what Jesus said. And I, folks, listen now. I've been a pastor for quite a few years, and I watch people, and I can almost feel the vibes, if you will. I see them coming to the altar. I see them really reaching out to God and all of that. And I see a lot of them go back and never be touched by God. But God, listen, is wanting to work in different areas in their life. It's not always a bodily healing. I don't know about you, but I'd rather be full of joy and have to live all my life. Listen, I can spend my whole life praying for a leg problem or something in my body and not have no joy in my life. I need to be healed with my joy. I need to have the joy of the Lord, because it's my strength today. And it's your strength today. This man, as he stood in the midst, Jesus was going to go farther. And I read to y'all the opposition that faced him there. Listen, but Jesus let it go on by. He said, "Sir, stretch forth your hand." And immediately, no resistance again. The man stretched forth his hand. And the Bible said, immediately, that man's hand was made whole. I don't know about you, but I need to be made whole. Listen, I need some things in my life, and you need some things in your life, and it's not necessarily a withered hand. It may be a withered wallet. I know folks don't believe that God will heal this, but He will. He's got a way to take care of the things in our life. There's many things in our life that has withered, and we've allowed it to wither. Listen, sometimes it's relationship, sometimes it's financial, sometimes it's spiritual. So listen, many areas in our life that God wants to heal in our lives and in our bodies. And I know today that God's going to show you through this Word right here what He's capable of doing. There's no limitation on God. The only limitation is what I put and what you put, what you allow to take place and what I allow to take place. I was standing in the church about a year ago. See, I told y'all I was going to use two things. One is experience, and the other one was the Word of God. I'm standing in my church on an average Sunday night, and I've been struggling with my hip for a long time. And I don't tell a lot of folks things, even my wife, and she's a worry ward, and I'm struggling. I mean, really struggling, folks, to work to the point where I was about ready to make a doctor's appointment. I was hurting so bad in my hip, and I would lay on my bed at night, and I'd think, "Lord, I know You're able to heal me, but God, maybe I ought to go ahead and go to the doctor." And I'm not saying don't go to the doctor. I'm just saying that this was my thoughts for several months, and I had already been looking for a couple doctors to go get looked at my hip and see what was going on, because it was difficult. It was almost like this man's withered hand. It was causing me. I wasn't living, but when I was around the house and stuff, didn't nobody see me, I lived a little bit, but it was bothering me bad. You know, I'm 55 years old, and that's starting to get a little bit old up in life. Well, maybe in a amen. When I was 20, 55 seemed ancient, but when I got 40, 55 didn't seem for that. Now I'm 55, man, it still feels pretty good. What I'm saying is I was struggling. And one night, I'm standing in the church, and I'm up doing the music, and somebody's up singing, and the Holy Ghost spoke to my heart right there, and He said, "I'm going to heal somebody in this place tonight. You tell them." And I've learned to listen to the Spirit of God. And so I told him, I said, "God's going to heal somebody in this place tonight." You folks got excited, something let it go right over their head. anymore. And when I finally realized that God spoke to my heart and said, you can remember that night that I told you to tell the church I was going to heal somebody. He said, it was you. And he touched my body. And I tell you, my leg that has been wonderful for almost a year now. So I can tell you from experience, God is a healer. He's able to touch your body. I don't care what the doctor said. I don't care what the report said. I don't care about none of this. That God, Jesus Christ, is still a healer of the body. So here's this man with the withered hand. Now all of a sudden, he's made whole. So what, preacher? Well, let me back up just a little bit. I want to back up just a little bit to chapter 5 now. See, what we got to understand is there's some ingredients that has to be in the sanctuary or wherever.